Laudator Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ. A very warm welcome to you on behalf of Vatican Media and all my colleagues here at the Vatican Dicastery for Communication. I'm Sean Patrick Lovett, and it's my privilege and pleasure to provide the commentary for this live broadcast of the canonization ceremony presided over by Pope Francis here in St. Peter's Square. This morning we're going to hear and see Pope Francis recognizing the sanctity, the holiness of Pope Paul VI, Blessed Pope Paul VI, Giovanni Battista Montini, Archbishop Oscar Arnulfo Romero, but also of Francesco Spinelli, Vincenzo Romano, Mary Catherine Casper, and Nazaria Ignazia from Spain, and last but certainly not least, Blessed Nunzio Sulprizio, a young layperson who died at just 19 years of age and whom the Pope will be presenting as a model for young people, very pertinent to the Synod of Bishops on young people currently taking place here in the Vatican. On whatever platform, medium, or device you may be following this event, please know we're truly delighted you could join us. We welcome especially our friends of Catholic TV, Salt and Light TV, Shalom World TV, EWTN TV, Net TV, and the Catholic Faith Network TV, and of course all of you who are listening on local radio stations around the world. This broadcast is also available live right now on our Vatican Media audio app and our Vatican News portal, which you can access at www.vaticannews.va. The Sistine Chapel Choir, in the background of my voice, announces the fact that the cardinals and bishops and those concelebrating with the Holy Father are exiting St. Peter's Basilica through the main door at this very moment to take their place around the altar where the Holy Mass will be celebrated, at the beginning of which the canonization process will be announced. Pope Francis makes his entrance onto the area in front of St. Peter's Basilica, the area we know as the Sagrato, the raised area in front of the facade of St. Peter's. If you're watching this on television or on our media app, then you will have already seen that St. Peter's Square is literally filled to overflowing with pilgrims and visitors. When I say overflowing, I mean literally beyond the colonnades and beyond the confines of the square, right down into the Via della Conciliazione, the major road that leads up to the Basilica. Seven banners adorn the facade of the Basilica, each one bearing the image of one of the seven people whose holiness will be recognized by Pope Francis today. I keep using that verb because a canonization is a statement by the Church that an individual is truly in heaven. The Church doesn't make saints. The Pope doesn't create a saint. There's a process that goes through a phase of beatification and then finally canonization, by which the Church definitively recognizes the heroic sanctity of an individual. In this case, there are seven of them, and it's one of the reasons why there are so many people in St. Peter's Square today, because these seven, in a sense, are a synthesis of the Catholicity, the universality of our Church. We have a Pope, Paul the Sixth. He becomes the fourth Pope to be canonized, the fourth Pope of the 20th century. Several popes were canonized in the early centuries, but he's the fourth Pope of the 20th century to be canonized, along with, of course, John the 23rd and Saint John Paul II. People coming from all over the world, as I said, because there are many from Latin America. Oscar Romero is certainly Now, he's the first saint from El Salvador, but he's certainly being held up as the new Latin American saint. And then, of course, that the Mary Catherine Casper was from Germany. We have the Italians, Francesco Spinelli, Vincenzo Romano, and Nunzio Sulprizio, and Blessed Nazaria Ignazia of St. Teresa of Jesus. She was born in Madrid, Spain. So there are representatives from all these countries. There are dignitaries here, members of the diplomatic corps, and lots of pilgrims and faithful wanting to be here present to recognize and to celebrate their new saints. The Holy Father incenses this historic wooden image of Our Lady and the Child Jesus that you will often see displayed during papal ceremonies. And in front of the statue, in front of the image of Our Lady and the Christ Child blessing, you will see the relics, the reliquaries, and the containing the relics of the seven individuals who will be canonized here today. The ceremony begins with the Holy Father blessing the altar with the incense in preparation for the ceremony, in preparation for the celebration of Holy Mass, which is the central element of our faith, and it's around this celebration that the canonization takes place. Before the event begins, allow me a very personal reflection. This celebration is extremely meaningful for me personally because it was on Saturday, August the 12th, 1978, that I sat exactly where I'm sitting now in this commentary booth in St. Peter's to provide the English radio and television commentary for the ceremony for the burial of Pope Paul VI. So for me, it's extremely personal and important to be here. In a sense, it's closing a circle. I provided the commentary for his burial ceremony and also for his beatification. And here we are to celebrate his canonization today. The ceremony begins with the words of the Holy Father. Let's listen to Pope Francis.
Amen.
Pax vobis.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
This is the introductory rite, and as is traditional with a canonization ceremony, we begin with a hymn to the Holy Spirit. We call upon the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, come from your bright heavenly throne, take possession of our souls, make them all thine own. I'm sure you know the words. Let's listen to this beautiful Catholic hymn.
Thank you.
The rite of canonization takes place immediately right at the beginning of the celebration, and so we see the prefect of the Congregation for the Causes of Saints processing up to the altar together with the postulators for the causes of these seven saints we are recognizing today.
Beatissime Pater.
This is Cardinal Giovanni Becciu.
Per santitate vestram catalogo santorum ascribi, et anquam santos ab omnibus Christi fidelibus pronunciari.
He literally petitions the Holy Father, saying, Holy Mother Church beseeches your holiness to enroll, and then he gives the names of the blessed.
Vincentium Romano, Marian Catarinam Casper, Nazarian Ignatiam a Santa Theresia a Jesu March Mesa, et Nuntium Sulpizio.
He asks that they may be enrolled among the saints, that they may be invoked as such by all the Christian faithful. Right now he is giving a brief biography of the seven blessed, beginning with Paul VI, Giovanni Battista Montini, born in Concesio Brescia on the 26th of September 1897, ordained priest in 1920. In 1937 he was appointed substitute of the Secretariat of State. During the Second World War he promoted charity and hospitality for those persecuted by Nazi fascism, especially Jews. Cardinal Becciu continues, Archbishop Becciu continues with this biography of Paul VI, saying he was pro-Secretary of State for Ordinary Affairs and in 1954 was appointed Archbishop of Milan. St. John XXIII made him a cardinal in 1958. He was elected Pope on the 21st of June 1963, taking the name of Paul VI. Among his many initiatives are those of concluding and applying the Second Vatican Council, his apostolic journeys, as well as ecumenical and interreligious dialogue. After a brief illness, he died in Castel Gandolfo on the evening of August the 6th, 1978. He was beatified in 2014 by yourself, Your Holiness, Pope Francis.
Nacque il 15 agosto 1917 a Ciudad de Barrios nella Repubblica di El Salvador.
Blessed Oscar Arnulfo Romero Galdames was born on August 15, 1917 in Ciudad Barrios in the Republic of El Salvador. In 1942, he received his priestly ordination, and for 20 years he was parish priest in the Diocese of San Miguel. In 1970, he was appointed auxiliary of San Salvador, then Bishop of Santiago de Maria, and in 1977, Archbishop of San Salvador. In the meantime, a serious political crisis erupted in the country, which led to civil war. After witnessing the violence being perpetrated against the weak, as well as the murder of priests and catechists, Archbishop Romero felt it was his pastoral duty to take action. On March 24, 1980, he was assassinated while celebrating Mass. Your Holiness, Pope Francis declared him blessed in 2015. Blessed Francesco Spinelli was born in Milan on April 14, 1853. After completing his priestly formation, he was ordained in 1875. He started a community of young women in Rome who consecrated their lives to Eucharistic adoration. After meeting St. Catherine Comensoli, he founded the Institute of the Adorers of the Blessed Sacrament. Blessed Francesco Spinelli fulfilled the role of both founder and superior. He died peacefully on February the 6th, 1913, and Pope St. John Paul II declared him blessed in 1992.
Il beato Vincenzo Romano nacque a Torre del Greco presso Napoli il 3 giugno 1700.
Blessed Vincenzo Romano was born in Torre del Greco near Naples on June the 3rd, 1751. In 1775, he was ordained a priest. His ministry was characterized by his special attention to those most in need and his commitment to educating children and young people.
Torre del Greco fu quasi completamente distrutta da una.
On June 15, 1794, the town of Torre del Greco was almost completely destroyed by a violent eruption of Mount Vesuvius. Blessed Vincenzo Romano spearheaded both the material and spiritual rebirth of the community. He died on December 20, 1831, and Blessed Pope Paul VI declared him blessed in 1963. Blessed Mary Catherine Casper was born on the 26th of May 1820 in Dernbach in Germany. She was a strong and extrovert child and spent her adolescence working in the fields and breaking stones for the construction of roads. It was in this context that she chose to found an institute of sisters at the service of the humblest social classes. In 1848, she opened the House of the Poor Handmaids of Jesus Christ, where the poor of the country were welcomed. The congregation spread rapidly, even outside Germany and Europe, reaching the Americas and later India. She died of a heart attack on February 2, 1898. Blessed Paul VI proclaimed her blessed in 1978.
La Beata Nazaria Ignazia de Santa Teresa di Gesù Marc Mesa nacque a Madrid.
Blessed Nazaria Ignazia of Saint Teresa of Jesus Marc Mesa was born in Madrid, Spain, on January 10, 1889. Her family moved to Mexico, where she met the Sisters of the Abandoned Elders and entered the Institute in 1908. After making her first vows in 1911, she was sent to Bolivia. As she became aware of the increasingly problematic social situation there, Nazaria founded the Congregation of the Missionary Crusaders of the Church to serve the poor and to assist women. Her life was in grave danger both in Bolivia and in Spain during the Civil War from 1936 to 1939. In 1942, she traveled from Spain to Buenos Aires, Argentina, but her health deteriorated. She died on July 6, 1943, and was beatified in 1992 by Pope St. John Paul II. Blessed Nunzio Sulprizio was born on April 13, 1817, in Pesco San Sonesco, in the province of Pescara, in Italy. Orphaned of both parents at the age of six, he was cared for by his maternal grandmother, who taught him to look for Jesus present in the Eucharist and to invoke the Blessed Virgin. When his grandmother died, Nunzio was entrusted to an uncle with whom he worked as a blacksmith. Hard work and ill treatment caused him to contract bone tuberculosis. He moved to Naples and was admitted to the hospital for incurable diseases. There he was able to receive his long-desired First Communion. But the disease degenerated quickly and he died on May the 5th, 1836. Nunzio was just 19 years old. It was Pope Leo XIII who decreed his heroic virtues in 1890 and proposed him as a model for young people. On December 1st, 1963, Blessed Pope Paul VI proclaimed him blessed. A pope, an archbishop, two priests, two women religious founders, and a young layperson. Truly the Catholic Church in synthesis. The prefect of the Congregation for the Causes of Saints, having petitioned the Holy Father and read the names and biographies of those for whom he requests canonization, now processes back and leaves the word to the Holy Father, who continues the litany of supplication.
Dio Patri Onnipotenti, Preces Nostras, per Jesum Christum levem, o Beate Maria Virginis, et Omnium Sanctorum Suorum Intercessione, Sua Gratia sostiniat, id quod solenniter actori sumus.
Let us lift up our prayers to God, the Father Almighty, through Jesus Christ, that through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all his saints, he may sustain with his grace the act which we now solemnly undertake. Now we begin this beautiful litany of the saints, this roll call of the saints of the Catholic Church. Each name is recited, followed by the refrain, Ora pro nobis, pray for us.
Preces populi tui, quae sumus Domine, benignus admite. urco affamulato nostro gerimus et tibi placiat, et ecclesiae tue proficiat incrementis. Per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
We ask you, Lord, graciously to accept the prayers of your people that our devoted service may be pleasing to you and contribute to the growth of your church. There follows now the official formula of canonization. The formula pronounced by the Holy Father. Let's listen to it a moment and then I will translate for you.
Exaltationem fidei catholice et vitae christiane incrementum. Autoritate Domini nostri Iesu Christi, Beatorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli ac nostra, matura deliberazione preabita et divina ope sepius implorata, ac de plurimorum fratrum nostrorum consilio, Beatus Paulum Sextum, Ansgarium Arnolfum Romero Galdames, Franciscum Spinelli, Vincentium Romano, Mariam Catarinam Casper, Nazarian Ignatian a Santa Teresia a Jesu March Mesa, et Nuncium Sulpizio, Santos esse decernimus et definimus, ac Santorum catalogo ascribimus, statuentis eos in universa ecclesia, inter santos pia devotioni recoli debere, in nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti.
Amen.
And the response is a Jubilate Deo. With this canonization formula, the Pope has officially declared the new saints. The formula of canonization you heard recites for the honor of the Blessed Trinity, the exaltation of the Catholic faith, and the increase of the Christian life by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ and of the holy apostles Peter and Paul and our own, after due deliberation and frequent prayer for divine assistance, and having sought the counsel of many of our brother bishops, we declare and define, and the Pope listed the seven blessed, to be saints, and we enroll them among the saints, decreeing that they are to be venerated as such by the whole Church.
Decernimus.
He responds, Decernimus, the Holy Father, we so decree, in response to Cardinal Becciu's final petition, in which he asks the Holy Father in the name of the Church, and he thanks the Holy Father for making this proclamation. He says, we humbly request that you decree that an apostolic letter concerning this act of canonization be drawn up. And the Pope responds in Latin, Decernimus, we so decree. We proceed immediately to the singing of the Gloria by the Sistine Chapel Choir.
Amen.
The Pope now prays the collect, and we proceed after that to the liturgy of the word.
Tua nos quesum Domine gratia, semper et preveniat et sequatur, ac bonis operibus iugiter prestet esse intentos. Per Dominum nostrum, Iesum Christum, Filium Tuum, qui te convivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
There are no special Mass readings for a canonization ceremony, so during the Liturgy of the Word, readings for this Sunday are used, this Sunday being the 28th Sunday in Ordinary Time, and the first reading taken from the Book of Wisdom, read for us here in St. Peter's Square in Italian.
Pregai, e mi fu elargita la prudenza. Implorai, e venne in me lo spirito di sapienza.
I prayed, and understanding was given me. I entreated, and the spirit of wisdom came to me. I esteemed her more than scepters and thrones. Compared with her, I held riches as nothing. I reckoned no priceless stone to be her peer, for compared with her, all gold is a pinch of sand, and beside her, silver ranks as mud. I preferred her more than health or beauty, preferred her to the light, since her radiance never sleeps. In her company, all good things came to me, at her hands, riches not to be numbered. That was the reading from the Book of Wisdom, chapter 7. And we proceed now to the responsorial psalm, Fill us with your love that we may rejoice, Psalm 89.
Saziaci, Signore, con il tuo amore, gioiremo per sempre.
Saziaci, Signore, con il tuo amore, gioiremo per sempre.
Insegnaci a contare i nostri giorni e acquisteremo un cuore saggio. Ritorna, Signore, fino a quando abbi pietà dei tuoi servi.
Saziaci, Signore, con il tuo amore, gioiremo per sempre.
Saziaci al mattino con il tuo amore, esulteremo e gioiremo per tutti i nostri giorni. Rendici la gioia per i giorni in cui ci hai afflitti, per gli anni in cui abbiamo visto il male. Manifesti ai tuoi servi la tua opera e il tuo splendore ai loro figli. Sia su di noi la dolcezza del Signore nostro Dio. Rendi salda l'opera delle nostre mani, l'opera delle nostre mani rendi salda.
The second reading will be read for us here in Spanish. It's taken from St. Paul's letter to the Hebrews, chapter 4.
De la carta a los Hebreos. Hermanos, la palabra de Dios es viva y eficaz, más tajante que espada de doble filo.
The word of God is something alive and active. It cuts like any double-edged sword, but more finely. It can slip through the place where the soul is divided from the spirit, or joints from the marrow. It can judge the secret emotions and thoughts. No created thing can hide from him. Everything is uncovered and open to the eyes of the one to whom we must give account of ourselves. While the choir sings the Alleluia verse, "How happy are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven," Pope Francis prepares the thurifer, the incense with which the Book of the Gospels will be reverenced before the proclamation of the Gospel. That flourishing brass fanfare accompanies the procession of the Book of the Gospels to the Ambo. We will hear the Gospel proclaimed in both Latin and in Greek. Those of you who are following in your missalettes, the Gospel today is from Mark chapter 10, verses 17 to 30. The Book of the Gospels is reverenced with the incense, and as I said, we will be listening to the Gospel proclaimed both in Latin and in Greek.
In illo tempore, cume crederetur Iesus in viam, accurrens quidam, et genuflexo anteum rogabat eum. Magister bone, quid faciam ut vitam aeternam percipiam. Iesus autem dixit ei, quid medicis bonum.
At that time Jesus was setting out on a journey, when a man ran up, knelt before him, and put this question to him. Good Master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus said to him, Why do you call me good? No one is good, but God alone.
Ec omnia conservavia juventute mea.
You know the commandments. You must not kill. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not bring false witness. You must not defraud. Honor your father and mother. And he said to him, Master, I have kept all these from my earliest days. Jesus looked steadily at him and loved him and said, There is one thing you lack. Go and sell everything you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. But his face fell at these words, and he went away sad, for he was a man of great wealth.
Fili, quam difficile est in regnum Dei introire, facilius est camelum per foramen acus transire, quam divitem intrare in regnum Dei. Qui magis admirabantur dicentes ad semet ipsos, et qui potes salvus fieri. Intuens illos Iesus ait, apud homines impossibile est, sed non apud Deum. Omnia enim possibilia sunt apud Deum. Cepit Petrus ei dicere, Ecce nos dimisimus omnia, et secuti sumus te. Ait Iesus, amen dico vobis, nemo est, qui reliquerit domum, aut fratres, aut sorores, aut matrem, aut patrem, aut filios, aut agros, propter me et propter evangelium, qui non accipiat centiestantum, nunc in tempore hoc, domos et fratres, et sorores, et matres, et filios, et agros, cum persecutionibus, et in seculo futuro vitam aeternam. Verbum Domini.
The deacon who proclaimed the gospel for us in Latin now exchanges places with the deacon who invites us wisdom, he says, standing, let us listen to the holy gospel. And the Pope responds in Greek, peace be with you.
Tu κατά Μάρκον Αγίο Ευαγγελίου το ανάγνωσμα. Ως
This is the same gospel reading, Mark chapter 10, verses 17 to 30.
Προσκομέν το καιρό εκείνο εκπορευωμένου του Ιησού εις οδόν προς δραμών εις καίγον υπετήσας αυτόν επωράτα αυτόν. Διδάσκαλε αγαθέ, τι πείσω είναι ζωήν αιώνιον κληρονομίζω. Ο δε Ιησούς είπεν αυτό, τι με λέγεις αγαθόν, ουδείς αγαθός ημί εις ο Θεός. Τας εν το λασίδας μη φωνεύσεις, μη μικεύσεις, μη κλέψεις, μη ψετομαρτυρίζεις, μη αποστερίζεις τίμα τον πατέρα σου και την μητέρα. Ο δε έφη αυτό διδάσκαλε ταύτα πάντα εφυλαξάμην εκ νεότητος μου. Ο δε Ιησούς εμβλέψας αυτό, ηγάπησεν αυτόν και είπεν αυτό. Εν σε υστερή είπαγε όσα έχεις πόλησον και δός της πτώκης και εξής θησαυρών εν ουρανό. Και δε προακουλήθημι, ο δε στιγνάσας επί το λόγο απήλθεν λυπούμενος, ειν γαρ έχων κτήματα πολλά. Και περιπλανόν ο Ιησούς λέγει τις μαθητές αυτού.
Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how hard it is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were astounded by these words. But Jesus insisted, my children, he said to them, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. They were more astonished than ever. In that case, they said to one another, who can be saved? Jesus gazed at them. For men, he said, it is impossible, but not for God, because everything is possible for God. Peter took this up. What about us? He asked him. We've left everything and followed you. Jesus said, I tell you solemnly, there is no one who has left house, brothers, sisters, father, children, or land for my sake and for the sake of the gospel, who will not be repaid 100 times over. Houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and land, not without persecutions, now in this present time and in the world to come, eternal life.
Ουδείς έστιν ως άφηγεν οικίαν οι αδελφούς, οι αδελφάς, η μητέρα, η πατέρα, η τέκνα, η αγρούς, ένε και νε μου και ένε και εν του Ευαγγελίου. Εάν μιλάβει εκατοντοπλασίων ανήν εν το καιρό τούτο οικίας και αδελφούς και αδελφάς, και μητέρας και τέκνα και αγρούς μετά διαγμών και εν το αιώνι το ερχομένο ζωήν αιώνιον.
the choir chants the praise to you, O Lord, the deacon carries the book of the Gospels to the Holy Father, who reverences it with a kiss, and with the book of the Gospels held high, blesses the assembly gathered here in St. Peter's Square, but also you who are following this Holy Mass and rite of canonization on radio, television, or the internet. That last chant in Greek is Ad multos annos. May you live long, Holy Father. And the Holy Father, Pope Francis, now presents his homily. He preaches his homily during this Holy Mass. Let's listen to him, and I will provide an English commentary for you.
È parola viva che tocca la vita, che la trasforma. Lì Gesù in persona, lui che è la parola vivente di Dio.
Pope Francis begins by referencing the second reading we heard during this Mass, Paul's letter to the Hebrews. The second reading, he says, tells us that the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It really is, says Pope Francis. God's Word is not merely a set of truths or an edifying spiritual account. No, it is a living Word that touches our lives, that transforms our lives. There, Jesus in person, the living Word of God, speaks to our hearts.
La vita in pienezza. Qui di noi non la vorrebbe.
And the Gospel in particular invites us to an encounter with the Lord after the example of the man who ran up to him, quoting from Mark. We can recognize ourselves in that man, says the Pope, whose name the text does not give, as if to suggest that he could represent each one of us. He asks Jesus how to inherit eternal life. He is seeking life without end, life in its fullness. Who of us would not want this?
La risposta di Gesù lo spiazza.
Yet we notice that he asks for it as an inheritance, as a good to be obtained, to be won by his own efforts. In fact, in order to possess this good, he has observed the commandments from his youth, and to achieve this, he is prepared to follow others. And so he asks, what must I do to have eternal life? Jesus' answer catches him off guard. The Lord looks upon him and loves him. Jesus changes the perspective from commandments observed in order to obtain a reward to a free and total love. That man was speaking in terms of supply and demand. Jesus proposes to him a story of love. He asks him to pass from the observance of laws to the gift of self, from doing for oneself to being with God. And the Lord suggests to the man a life that cuts to the quick, sell what you have and give to the poor and come, follow me. To you too, Jesus says, come, follow me. Come. Do not stand still, because it's not enough not to do evil in order to be with Jesus. Follow me. Do not walk behind Jesus only when you want to, but seek him out every day. Do not be content to keep the commandments, to give a little alms, and say a few prayers. Find in him the God who always loves you. Seek in Jesus the God who is the meaning of your life, the God who gives you the strength to give of yourself.
per fare posto a lui, unico bene. Non si può seguire.
Again, Jesus says, sell what you have and give to the poor. The Lord does not discuss theories of poverty and wealth, but goes directly to life. He asks you to leave behind what weighs down your heart, to empty yourself of goods, in order to make room for Him, the only good. We cannot truly follow Jesus when we are laden down with things. Because if our hearts are crowded with goods, there will not be room for the Lord, who will become just one thing among the others. For this reason, wealth is dangerous, and, Jesus says, even makes one's salvation difficult. Not because God is strict, no, the problem is on our part, our having too much, our wanting too much, suffocates our hearts and makes us incapable of loving. Therefore, St. Paul writes that the love of money is the root of all evils. We see this where money is at the center, there is no room for God nor man. Jesus is radical. He gives all, and He asks all. He gives a love that is total, and asks for an undivided heart. Even today, He gives Himself to us as the living bread. Can we give Him crumbs in exchange? We cannot respond to Him who made Himself our servant, even going to the cross for us, only by observing some of the commandments. We cannot give Him who offers us eternal life some odd moment of time. God is not content with a percentage of love. We cannot love Him 20 or 50 or 60%. It's either all or nothing. Dear brothers and sisters, our heart is like a magnet. It lets itself be attracted by love, but it can cling to one master only, and it must choose. Either it will love God or it will love the world's treasure. Either it will live for love or it will live for itself. Let us ask ourselves where we are in our story of love with God. Do we content ourselves with a few commandments, or do we follow Jesus as lovers, really prepared to leave behind something for Him? Jesus asks each of us and all of us, as the Church journeying forward, are we a Church that only preaches good commandments, or a Church that is a spouse, that launches herself forward in love for her Lord? Do we truly follow Him, or do we revert to the ways of the world, like that man in the Gospel? In a word, is Jesus enough for us, or do we look for many worldly securities? Let us ask for the grace always to leave things behind for love of the Lord, to leave behind wealth, the yearning for status and power, structures that are no longer adequate for proclaiming the Gospel, those weights that slow down our mission, the strings that tie us to the world. Without a leap forward in love, our life and our Church becomes sick from complacency and self-indulgence. We find joy in some fleeting pleasure. We close ourselves off in useless gossip. We settle into the monotony of a Christian life without momentum, where a little narcissism covers over the sadness of remaining unfulfilled.
Non aveva dato il cuore.
This is how it was for the man who, the Gospel tells us, went away sorrowful. He was tied down to regulations of the law and to his many possessions. He hadn't given over his heart, even though he had encountered Jesus and received his loving gaze. The man went away sad. Sadness is the proof of unfulfilled love, the sign of a lukewarm heart. On the other hand, a heart unburdened by possessions that freely loves the Lord always spreads joy, that joy for which there is so much need today. Pope Saint Paul VI wrote, "It is indeed in the midst of their distress that our fellow men need to know joy, to hear its song." Today Jesus invites us to return to the source of joy, which is the encounter with Him, the courageous choice to risk everything to follow Him, the satisfaction of leaving something behind in order to embrace His way. The saints have traveled this path. Paul VI did too, after the example of the apostle whose name he took. Like him, Paul VI spent his life for Christ's gospel, crossing new boundaries and becoming its witness in proclamation and in dialogue, a prophet of a church turned outwards, looking to those far away and taking care of the poor. Even in the midst of tiredness and misunderstanding, Paul VI bore witness in a passionate way to the beauty and the joy of following Christ totally. Today, he still urges us, together with the council whose wise helmsman he was, to live our common vocation, the universal call to holiness. Not to half measures, but to holiness. It's wonderful that together with him and the other new saints today, there is Archbishop Romero, who left the security of the world, even his own safety, in order to give his life according to the gospel, close to the people and to the poor, with a heart drawn to Jesus and his brothers and sisters.
Del nostro ragazzo napolitano Nunzio sul Prizio, il santo giovane, coraggioso, umile, che ha saputo incontrare Gesù nella sofferenza, nel silenzio e l'offerta di se stesso. Tutti questi santi in diversi contesti.
We can say the same about Francesco Spinelli, Vincenzo Romano, Mary Catherine Casper, Nazaria Ignazio of St. Jesus, of St. Teresa of Jesus, and Nunzio sul Prizio. And there Pope Francis goes off script.
Il Signore ci aiuti a imitare il loro esempio.
The Pope stopped on the name of Nunzio sul Prizio. You'll remember he is the young person, and if you're watching, that's his image on the tapestry in front of St. Peter's right now. He died at only 19 years of age, and he is being held up as an example to young people, especially timely as this is the time of the Synod on young people. Our young person, Nunzio, said Pope Francis, who was young and courageous and humble and encountered Jesus in suffering and in silence, offering himself. With all these saints in different contexts, they all put today's word into practice in their lives, without lukewarmness, without calculation, without the passion to risk, and with the passion to risk everything and to leave everything behind. May the Lord help us, concluded Pope Francis, to imitate their example. A moment of silent reflection follows the Holy Father's homily. If you've just joined us, again, welcome to this live broadcast of Holy Mass with the canonization of 7 examples of faith and witness, beginning with Pope Paul VI, continuing with Oscar Arnulfo Romero, and then also with Francesco Spinelli, Vincenzo Romano, Mary Catherine Casper, Nazaria Ignazia, and of course the young person Nunzio Sulprizio. We pause now and we join in the singing of the Creed, the profession of our faith.
Fratelli e figli carissimi, nella gioia della comunione dei santi, presentiamo al Signore le necessità dell'ora presente in attesa di partecipare pienamente alla gloria futura.
The Holy Father introduces the universal prayer of the faithful.
Oremus pro Ecclesia Sancta Dei.
Let us pray for God's Holy Church as we listen to the first prayer of the faithful in German. nourished by the grace of the sacraments, sustained by the witness and intercession of the saints, may the Church always be resplendent with the beauty of her spouse.
Oremus pro legislatoribus et publicis moderatoribus.
We pray now for legislators and government leaders, and we do so in Chinese. Guided by the light of the Holy Spirit and by the authentic pursuit of the common good, may they dedicate themselves passionately to building up the civilization of love.
Oremus pro Christianis qui persecutiones patiuntur.
We pray now for persecuted Christians in Italian.
Colmi dello spirito di fortezza,
filled with the spirit of fortitude and proud to belong to the Lord Jesus, may they be gentle and tenacious witnesses to his paschal victory.
Oremus pro juvenibus vocationem querentibus.
In French now, we pray for young people discerning their vocations. Attracted by the newness of the gospel, and with their gaze fixed on Jesus, may they choose to make of their lives a total gift of love.
Oremus pro sponsis et coniugibus juvenibus.
In English now, we pray for engaged couples and newlyweds.
From every form of selfishness and from a worldly mindset, may they be open to freely giving themselves in thankfulness.
Ascolta, Padre, la preghiera della Chiesa che oggi gioisce per la testimonianza e la compagnia dei Santi, veri discepoli e amici di Gesù, tuo Figlio e nostro Signore. Egli vive e regna nei secoli dei secoli.
Amen. The Holy Father gathers together these prayers of the Universal Church and, addressing God the Father, says, here, the prayer of the Church, who today recognizes in the witness and company of the saints, true disciples and friends of Jesus, your Son, our Lord. We proceed now to the liturgy of the Eucharist. As the gifts are brought up to the altar, we'll be listening shortly to the choir singing the offertory hymn. The offertory hymn, Remember me, O Lord, thou who rulest above all power, and give a well-ordered speech in my mouth, that my words may be pleasing in the sight of the Prince. Very prominent here in St. Peter's Square, you will have seen, are the relics of the seven people who have been canonized today. Those relics have more than just a symbolic significance. They mean that churches may be built in the honor of these new saints, altars may be dedicated in their honor, masses may be celebrated, the divine office may be recited in their honor, and a feast day set aside to their memory. They may also be designated as special patrons. Some of you may already have a special devotion to some of them. The veneration of relics, in fact, is very much part of the Church's tradition. In the Second Vatican Council, the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy, it says quite specifically, the saints have been traditionally honored in the Church and their authentic relics and images held in veneration. We see their images here on display in front of St. Peter's Basilica. Pope Francis greeting a family with their little girl as they bring up the gifts which will be used during the celebration of Mass. One detail that I would like to share with you, you have seen the Holy Father using his pastoral cross, his pastoral staff. You've probably seen it before. It was used by John Paul II. Well, that pastoral staff was made especially for Paul VI. So there's a beautiful continuity in the symbolism here. Pope Francis using the staff, the pastoral staff that Saint Pope Paul VI carried with him as a pilgrim pope on his many travels around into the world. Pope Paul VI was the first pope to fly in an aircraft, the first pope to visit Africa, the United States, Latin America, Australia, the Philippines, the Holy Land. There's another important item that has symbolic value, I think, very especially for Pope Francis. It's not visible, and that is the waistband that he is wearing beneath his liturgical garments. He's wearing the waistband that was used by Oscar Romero when he was murdered, when he was assassinated while celebrating Mass in his local church. So we have these very strong physical, tangible connections to these two new saints, Paul VI and Oscar Romero. But let's listen now to the offertory hymn. Holy Father proceeds to reverence the gifts with the incense in preparation for the Eucharistic sacrifice of the Mass. Yesterday evening, Pope Francis crossed the Vatican Gardens to pay a private and personal visit to Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI, whom we know is, like you, following this celebration on radio and television at this very moment. And Pope Francis made that gesture because it was on the 27th of June, 1977, that Pope Saint Paul VI made Joseph Ratzinger a cardinal right here in St. Peter's Square. Deacon blesses the congregation, this massive congregation, St. Peter's Square, literally overflowing with pilgrims and visitors from all over the world. Let's listen now as the Holy Father pronounces the Eucharistic prayer.
Suscipe Domine fidelium preces cum oblationi vos ostiarum, ut per ecpie devotionis officia ad celestem gloriam transeamus. Per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Dominus obiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sursum corda.
Abemus ad Dominum.
Gratias agamus Domino Deo nostro.
Dignum et justum est.
Vere dignum et justum est, equum et salutare, nos tibi semper et ubique gratias agere. Domine, Sancte Pater, omnipotens eterne Deus, per Christum Dominum nostrum, cuius hoc mirificum fuit opus per Paschale Mysterium, ut de peccato et mortis jugo ad an gloriam vocaremur, quanum genus electum regale sacerdotium, gens santa et acquisitionis populus diceremus. Et tuas annunciaremus ubique virtutes, quid nos de tenebris ad un admirabile lumen vocast. Et ideo cum angelis et arcangelis, cum tronis et dominationibus, cum que omni militia celestis exercitus, hymnum gloriae tuae canimus in fine gen. Sanctus est Domine, et merito te laudat omnis a te condita creatura, quia per filium tuum Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum, Spiritus Sancti operante virtute, vivificas et sanctificas universa, et populum tibi congregare non desinis, ut a solis ortus ad ocasum oblatio munda offeratur nomine tuo. Supplices ergo te Domine deprecamur, ut ec munera, quae tibi sacranda detulimus, eodem spiritus sanctificare dinieris, ut corpus et sanguis fiam fili tui Domini nostri Iesu Christi, cuius mandato ec mysteria celebramus. Ipse enim, in qua nocte tradebatur, accepit panem, tibi gratias agens benedixit, fregit, dedique discipulis suis dicens, accipite et manducate ex hoc omnes. Hoc est enim corpus meum, quod pro vobis tradetur.
simili modo posconcenatum est accipiens calicem et tibi gratias agens benedic dedique discipulis suis dicem accipite et bibite ex eo omni hic est enim calic sanguinis mei novi et eterni testamenti qui pro vobis et pro multis et fundetur in remissionem peccatorum hoc facite in meam commemorationem.
Mysterium fidei.
Mortem tuam annunciamus Domine, et tuam resurrectionem confiteremus. Domine, venias.
Memores igitur Domine, eius in filii tui salutifere passione, nec noc mirabilia resurrectione, sed in cielo gloriosa ascensione. Offerimus tibi gratias referentes, hoc sacrificium vivum et sanctum. Respice quem sumus, siones ecclesiae tuae, et agnosen hostiam, cuius voluiste immolatione placari, concede uci corpore et sanguine, fili tui reficimus, spiritu eius santo repleti, unus corpus et unus spiritus inveniamur in Christo.
Ipse nos tibi perficiat munus eternum, ut cum electis tuis hereditatem consequi valeamus, in primis cum Beatissima Virgine Dei Genitrice Maria, cum Beato Iosef eius Ponso, cum Beatis Apostolis tuis et Gloriosis Martiribus, cum Santis Paulo, Ansgario Arnolfo, Francisco Vincenzio Marie Caterine, Nazarie Ignazie a Santa Teresia Iesu et Nunzio et omnibus Santis quorum intercessione perpetua apud te confidimus adiuvari.
Eg hostia nostre reconciliationibus profitiat quesimus Domine. A totius mundi pacem atque salutem ecclesiam tuam, peregrinantem in terra, in fide et caritate firmare digneris, cum famulo tuo Papa nostro Francisco, cum episcopali ordine et universo clero, et omni populo adquisitionis tue. Votis ius familie, quantibi astare voluisti, adesto propitius, omnis filios tuos ubique, dispersus tibi clemens pater, miseratus coniunge, frates nostres defuntus, et omnes qui tibi placentes, et ob seculo transierum, in regnum tuum benignus admite, ube fore esperamus, id simul gloria tuo perennitir setiemur. Per Christum Domine nostrum, perque mundo bona cumta largiris.
Per ipsum et cum ipso et in ipso est tibi Deo Patri Omnipotenti in unitate Spiritus Sancti omnis honor et gloria per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen. Amen.
Precepti salutaribus moniti et divina institutione formata, audemus dicere.
Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo.
Libera nos quaesumus Domine ab omnibus malis. Da propitius pacem in diebus nostris, ut ope misericordiae tuae adiuti, et a peccatos simus semper liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, spectantes beatam spem, et adventum salvatoris nostri Iesu Christi. Domine Iesu Christe, qui dixisti apostolis tuis, pacem relinquo vobis, pacem meam do vobis. Ne respicias peccata nostra, sed fiden ecclesiae tue, e anque secundum voluntatem tuam pacificare coadunare linieris, qui vives e regnas in saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini, si semper vobiscum.
Offerte vobis pacem.
This is the moment when we're all invited to share some sign of peace, to turn to the person nearest to us and to ask them pardon if we've offended them, to tell them that we care for them, that we love them as they are, and to stand here in St. Peter's Square and to see so many people from so many different, not just countries and nations, and but different experiences, religious and lay people, married people, young and old alike, turn to one another. It literally turns this square into an embrace of peace, which is what our church wants to be. An embrace of peace, an embrace of welcome. The several thousand priests celebrating at this Mass make their way now among the congregation for the distribution of Holy Communion, but first we'll be singing the Agnus Dei, Lamb of God, before proceeding to listening to the communion antiphon. Please take note of the chalice that Pope Francis is using. This was the chalice that belonged to Pope Paul VI, another very important connection between these two popes.
Thank you. Agnus Dei, exequitoli peccata mundi, beati che accennano agli invocati sum.
Domine, non sum dignus, ut intre suspectum meum, sed tanto dic verbo, et sanabitur anima mea.
The communion antiphon is from Psalm 118. Relieve me from scorn and contempt, for I do your will. Your will is my delight. Your statutes are my counselors. If you have just joined us, then a reminder that you are tuned to Vatican Media. This is our live broadcast of the Holy Mass with the canonization of seven blessed souls, beginning with Pope Paul VI and going through Archbishop Oscar Romero, and then Francesco Spinelli, Vincenzo Romano, Maria Catherine Casper, Nazaria Ignazia of St. Teresa of Jesus, and young Nunzio Sulprizio, for whom Pope Francis had special words of reflection during his homily when he literally went off the cuff right at the end, mentioning his name and spoke of him as a young man who was courageous and humble. He was certainly young. He died when he was 19. Courageous, humble, a young man who encountered Jesus, said Pope Francis, in suffering and in silence, offering himself. In fact, young Nunzio Sulprizio died of a degenerative bone tuberculosis in the Hospital for Incurable Diseases in Naples in 1836. During the Eucharistic prayer, if you were listening carefully, you would have heard one of the concelebrants. In fact, the Cardinal Archbishop of Naples, Cardinal Sepe, specifically mention the names of the new saints, including that of this young person who's being held up literally as a symbol for young people, in the same way as Pope Leo XIII did when he decreed his heroic virtues all the way back in 1890, proposing Nunzio Sulprizio as a model for young people. Everything the Church does has significance, has meaning that goes beyond what sometimes seems evident, and so the fact of canonizing Pope Paul VI at this moment in time, Oscar Romero and these other witnesses to the faith, all of these they're saying something to the Church of our time. Paul VI was the one who carried forward the theme of dialogue. We remember his encyclical Ecclesiam Suam of 1964. Emeritus Pope Benedict XVI, whom we know is following this ceremony right now, Pope Benedict, who was made cardinal by Paul VI in 1977, once defined Paul VI as superhuman. Pope Francis has said that Paul VI knew how to witness to the faith in Jesus in especially difficult times. We remember not only his encyclical Ecclesiam Suum, but of course Humanae Vitae, and his 1975 exhortation on evangelization, Evangelii Nuntiandi, proclaiming the gospel. Paul VI wrote there that the church itself has constant need of being evangelized, that people today listen more willingly to witnesses than to teachers. And if we do listen to teachers, it's because they are witnesses. And so what more beautiful, what better example could we be experiencing here in St. Peter's Square today than be confronted not just with teachers, but with witnesses, witnesses to the faith, people who gave their lives, literally, for Jesus. That was at the heart of Pope Francis' homily earlier during the Mass, commenting on the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 10, that very familiar Gospel story of the wealthy young man who comes to Jesus and asks what he must do to inherit eternal life, and that incredibly poignant phrase, that image of Jesus who looks at him, who sees him, who loves him, and invites him to leave everything and follow him. Pope Francis, in his reflections after that Gospel reading, returns to that idea of our Lord asking us too to leave everything to follow him. The Lord, he said, doesn't discuss theories. He goes directly to life. He asks us to leave behind what weighs down our hearts. We cannot truly follow him, he says, when we are laden down with things. We need to empty ourselves of goods in order to make room for him who is the only good. If our hearts are crowded with goods, there's no room for the Lord, says Pope Francis, who just becomes something else amongst the many things that we possess. And that's why wealth is dangerous, and that's why Jesus says it's so difficult for a wealthy person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Wanting too much, said Pope Francis, suffocates us. It makes us incapable of loving. That's why St. Paul tells us that the love of money is the root of all evil. But my favorite part of Pope Francis' homily earlier during the Mass is towards the end, when he speaks of how the rich man, who is never named in the Gospel, because, as the Holy Father reminded, we can so easily identify, we're meant to identify with him. This unnamed individual goes away, and the Gospel uses the word, Mark uses the word, sorrowful. He's tied down by rules and regulations, by possessions. Even though he's encountered Jesus, he's seen and be seen by Jesus, he goes away sad. And this is what I like about what the Pope said. He said, sadness is the proof of unfulfilled love. It's the sign of a lukewarm heart, a heart that's unburdened by possessions, that freely loves the Lord, always spreads joy, a joy of which there is so much need today, as we all know. It was Pope St. Paul VI who wrote, "It's indeed in midst of their distress that our fellow humans need to know joy and to hear its song." And Pope Francis in his homily says Jesus is inviting us here today, now, to return to the source of joy, which is the encounter with him, to have the courageous choice to risk everything to follow him, the satisfaction of leaving something behind in order to embrace his way, the same way that the saints we're celebrating today, have followed.
Thank you.
the cameras of Vatican Media panning over the tapestries, these enormous tapestries, beautiful images of the saints we're celebrating here, these exemplary individuals who by their lives, by their examples, give us hope, give us inspiration, perhaps remind us that we too could be like them. Each one of them representing a different lifestyle. We have women religious, we have priests, we have this young person from Naples. Each one reminding us through their example that holiness is possible. Some might think that seven is quite a large number of people to be raising to the altars. In fact, it's not a record number at all. The largest canonization, at least to my knowledge, was held by Pope Francis in 2013, shortly after he was elected to the papacy. And it was the ceremony that saw the canonization of Laura Montoya Opegi, Maria Guadalupe Garcia Zavala, and the 800 martyrs of Otranto. Otranto in southern Italy, you can look them up, it's a fascinating story. 800 martyrs of Otranto who were martyred in 1480. So that apparently is the record for the greatest number of people canonized at any one time. There is significance in everything, in the fact of choosing this moment during the Synod of Bishops on young people to proclaim these individuals as saints.
Let's keep prayerful silence for some brief moments.
We're invited, as you heard from the by the speaker in the square, to spend a few moments in silent prayer and meditation and reflection. Unfortunately, on radio, there is no such thing as silence. And so I would invite you to go to our website, our Vatican News website, where very shortly you'll be able to read the Holy Father's homily. You can download that, you can reflect on that, you can share that with your friends, as well as the biographies of those who have been acknowledged saints today. We're spending a lot of attention, of course, rightly so, on Paul VI and Oscar Romero, but I think it is important to remember the others, Francesco Spinelli, Vincenzo Romano, Mary Catherine Casper, Nazaria Ignazia of St. Jesus, St. Teresa of Jesus, and Nunzio Sulprizio.
Oremus. Majestatem tuam, Domine, subliciter de precamur, ut sic ut nos corporis et sanguinis sacrosanti pacis alimento, ita divine nature facias esse consortes, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Cari fratelli e sorelle, prima di concludere questa Santa Messa, desidero salutare e ringraziare tutti voi.
Before concluding the Holy Mass, says Pope Francis, I want to greet you and to thank all of you. I thank my brother cardinals, says the Pope, and the many bishops and priests who've come from all over the world.
Che hanno contribuito al progresso spirituale e sociale nelle rispettive nazioni. In particolare saluto Sua Maestà la Regina Sofia, il Presidente.
I'm grateful to the official delegations of many countries who've come to pay tribute to the new saints and who've contributed to the spiritual and social progress of their respective nations. The applause is for Her Majesty Queen Sofia of Spain, whom the Holy Father greets in particular, and the President of Italy, the Presidents of Chile, El Salvador, and Panama, all of whom are present here. I also have a special greeting, says Pope Francis, for His Grace Rowan Williams and for the delegation of the Archbishop of Canterbury. I'm deeply grateful for your presence. My greeting goes out to all of you, dear pilgrims, as well as to you, those who are following by radio and television. I greet in particular the large groups of ACLI, that's the Christian Associations of Italian Workers, who continue to manifest their gratitude to Pope Paul VI. Let us now turn in prayer to the Virgin Mary, the first and most perfect disciple of the Lord. May she help us follow the example of the new saints.
Ave Maria, gracia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tui mulieribus et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Ecce ancilla Domini.
Fiat mihi secundum rectum tuum.
Ave Maria, gracia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tui mulieribus et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
E verbum caro factum est.
Et habitavit in nobis.
Ave Maria, gracia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tui mulieribus et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Ora pro nobis, Santa Dei Genetrix.
Tu dignitis facciamur promissionibus Christi.
Gratiam tuam quesum Domine mentibus nostris infunde, ut qui angelum nuntiante Christi Filii tui incarnationem coniovimus, per passionem eius et crucem, ad resurrectionis gloriam perducamur, per omnem Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sic ut erat in principio et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sic ut erat in principio et nunc et semper, Amen.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sic ut erat in principio et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Pro fidelibus defuntis, requiem aeterna dona eis Domine,
et lux perpetua luce a teis,
requiescant in pace.
Amen.
Domino vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sit nomen Domini benedictum.
Et sot nunque custo in saeculum.
Aiuterium nostrum in nomine Domini.
Qui fecit caelum et terra.
Benedicat vos, omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Remember that that blessing is as valid for you wherever you are and on whatever platform, whatever medium you may be following this canonization ceremony here. That blessing goes out to you. It's as valid for you as it is to the people who are standing in the square waving their flags and banners and at this very moment. Just witnessed another piece of history in the Catholic Church here this morning. With this canonization, Pope Francis has officially declared 7 new saints. The canonization formula is a decree that cannot be revoked. It's issued by the Pope himself, and prescribes universal veneration. It removes all doubt about the validity of honoring these individuals as saints. That is what canonization means, literally speaking infallibly and for the whole church, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, which is why at the beginning of the Mass the choir sang the invocation of the Veni Creator Spiritus. The person's name is entered into the canon of the saints, those who receive universal veneration in the church. This means that churches may be erected in their honor, masses celebrated in their honor, and feast days set aside to their memory. If you're watching the ceremony, you'll see the banners and the flags, you'll see the images of the newly canonized saints of the Catholic Church. If you're listening, you'll hear the choir singing the final hymn, which closes this Mass after thanking God for these new saints. And on those images and on those sounds, to those sounds, we conclude our live broadcast of the Holy Mass with canonizations, coming to you from St. Peter's Square in the Vatican. Do remember, this event is available on our Vatican YouTube channel and on our Vatican News portal, where you will find the text of the Holy Father's homily today, as well as reports on his other activities, and certainly every day on the Synod of Bishops. Be sure to interact with us on social media. Our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram accounts are updated constantly, and we'll be expecting you on vaticannews.va. Until next time, on behalf of Vatican Media, I'm Sean Patrick Lovett, wishing you every blessing. Laudator Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ.